The numbers are still going up, so we'll just give it a second.
Yep.
All right. Well, hello, everyone, and congratulations on your acceptance to Stony Brook University. I'm Nicole Sampson, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at Stony Brook, and I'd like to thank you for spending the next approximately hour with us to learn more about opportunities you'll have as a future Seawolf. We'll begin tonight with a presentation that discusses a widely known genre of music from a perspective you may not have thought about before, an example of what students can learn through courses offered by our Department of Music. And of course, we will address any questions you may have from academics to student life and more. You can simply enter them in the Q&A box. But first, I wanted to give you a bird's eye view of our campus. At the heart of the Stony Brook campus is the College of Arts and Sciences. This is the largest of the schools and colleges at Stony Brook University, and we have 26 departments and nearly 20 centers and institutes, and offers over 30 different majors and more than 40 minors. And with that, I would like to introduce our star tonight, Dr. Kevin Holt, an assistant professor in the Department of Music and one of our newest faculty members in the college. Dr. Holt's presentation of music, culture, and hip hop is an interdisciplinary exploration of hip hop. He ties in several disciplines, including history, musicology, gender, sexuality, queer studies, anthropology, performance studies, multicultural and ethnic studies, and literary criticism. Incidentally, each of these areas of studies is within the College of Arts and Sciences that you see here before you on this slide. I'd also like to introduce Anthony Machuca, a senior psychology and health science double major and a member of my student advisory council. So at this time, I will turn it over to Dr. Holt.
All right, good evening, everybody. Yeah, so just to get us started, I want to share that I'm an ethnomusicologist. So that essentially means that I research people and culture through music and sound. And one of my core areas is American popular music with an emphasis on hip hop and contemporary popular music. So today I'm going to be offering a quick introduction to my course, The Music and Culture of Hip Hop. And in this course, we focus on a few things. So we bring in, musical element things, so we focus on things like rhythm, melody, song structure, et cetera. And we also look at the historical context that created hip hop music. And the third thing that we look at is, the social, political, and aesthetic and philosophical ideas that drive the genre into different directions. Yeah, so one recurring conversation is the state of hip hop today. and that goes for whenever today happens to be. There's always a conversation about the state of hip hop today, and usually there is somebody saying that it's changed and potentially it's changed too much. So I'm going to play a quick excerpt of a contemporary hip hop song, something fairly recent. So I'm going to quickly share the screen. So this example is by Tyler Yahweh, Do No Wrong. I'm just gonna play it so that we get the song in our ears a little bit.
Dirty, sipping dirty with that 30. I'm a big phoenix, I've been working since a birdie. With a bad like a slurpee. Tired of the damn games, ain't no curse. You love me, but you're so concerned, ain't tryna hurt me. Torture my heart, kill me slowly but surely. Don't won't give in, Cartier my lens. Let this life a sin, this oops revenge. And I'm loving that, baby, where you going? I need some of that. I just got a gig for 500. That's enough to make a sit and do jumping jacks. Total mystery, I'm a jump on your phone too.
I'll pause there. I can keep the screen up. So this is a song that came out just about a month ago. And so for those of you who are fans of contemporary hip hop, I'm sure you've heard the debates about this sound not being core hip hop. And people, you know, will say that the old school way is kind of lost in this style because it's more melodic. It's doing more with changing the timbre. It doesn't sound natural, and it's not as easy to access in terms of its poetry. And I'm sure that it's kicked off a bit more since the last Super Bowl halftime show, because that was a big celebration of hip hop in the 90s. So they're definitely right about things changing, but those changes aren't without meaning or substance. So let's take it all the way back to the first hip hop record. You may or may not know this song, but I'm going to play a quick excerpt anyway. This is Sugar Hill Gang, Rapper's Delight.
Here's Wonder Mike, Hank, and Master G, the Sugar Hill Gang.
Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet. You see, I am Wonder Mike, and I like to say hello. Up to the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, and the purple, and yellow. But first, I gotta bang, bang, the boogie to the boogie. Say up, jump the boogie to the bang, bang, boogie, let's rock. You don't stop, rock the rhythm, that'll make your body rock. Well, so far, you've heard my voice, but I brought two friends along. And next on the mic is my man, Hank. Come on, Hank, sing that song. Check it.
All right, we could listen on and on, but you know, let's move on. And I'll actually stop the share. So usually when people talk about old school hip hop, they're not really referring to that sound. It doesn't register for most folks as core hip hop. It's a little too disco-y, too dancey, too bright. But even this isn't quite the beginning of the story. You know, this is the type of hip hop that most people in the late 1970s outside of New York encountered for the first time, but it's just not the beginning. So in order to get to the beginning, we need to go back further, and about another 10 years. This was 1979. We need to go back to the 1960s. So as I'm sure many of you know, hip hop began in the Bronx. It was the culmination of artistic elements that existed before, and they were braided together into a movement, right? And the core elements of hip hop are usually considered graffiti, dance, usually breaking, but also b-boying, emceeing, and DJing. And sometimes people offer knowledge as the fifth element. So one of the main aims of the artists in this movement was had to do with laying claim to space. So if you've ever navigated New York City, you know that there's a unique relationship between space and ownership. You'll have families and communities who occupy a specific space for generations, but the property is often owned by somebody outside of the community or even outside of the city. So here we have a kind of emotional and cultural ownership that's put up against legal ownership. You know, so this is especially true of poor and working class neighborhoods, and that was the case in the Bronx in the mid 20th century. When the city decided to build a cross Bronx expressway in order to make commuting to the city from New Jersey and Connecticut easier, they decided to pretty much weaponize that legal ownership against by displacing whole neighborhoods and asserting to the people in the Bronx that the neighborhoods they called home could be taken away at any moment. I stopped the share too quickly. I'm gonna share one more thing here. These are some images of the Bronx through the 1970s. I'm gonna scroll through slowly, but I want you to take in the structures, the state of the buildings, the state of the backgrounds, the people who are occupying the space, because that's really important here. As I mentioned, there was a massive construction project, the Cross Bronx Expressway, and that essentially cut off a lot of the neighborhoods that weren't outright destroyed, cut them off from easy access to the city. Many of the people here, it didn't make life easier for them. So the Bronx kind of went into a bit of urban decay. And it all sort of started from this assertion of not having true ownership. So these are the conditions that drove a lot of early hip hop movements. So it's not coincidental that visual artists tagged or spray painted buses and trains that went through the area, because it was a way of asserting ownership and belonging. And for the music, there was a different type of laying claim to space, through art. So DJs would create these huge sound systems and often siphon electricity off of the streetlights and use their improvisational and mixing and scratching of existing records to fuel street parties. They essentially laid claim to space by taking over city blocks and using them for their own purposes. In this instance, the purpose was partying. They'd also have MCs with them whose rap usually sounded more like what we'd call hype men today. So they had short two or four liners, but they weren't these long narrative forms. Since they had to be ready to change with the improvisation of the DJ, it didn't really make sense to have these much longer forms. So to be clear, there were MCs who would gather and have rap battles during this time, but the music of hip hop was squarely about the DJ at this point. So what you had on the scene was, again, these DJs who would collect records. They would take these found sound objects, mix them into wholly new things, and the structure was therefore very loose. And since they're playing for crowds, a good DJ would be able to change the music and the structure on the basis of what the crowd needs. That's really important for this early hip hop movement. It's dynamic and it's engaging and it's changing on the basis of what the crowd wants. So this is where Sylvia Robinson, a record producer and eventual producer of Rapper's Delight, the song we heard, saw an opportunity. Her only problem was it's almost impossible to commoditize a party. DJs felt nobody would buy a hip hop record because for them, real hip hop was improvised and again, had this dynamic interplay. And once it goes into being a new record, something that is the same every time it's played, they felt like it was doing something different and they didn't quite see how it fit into the record industry. So Robinson had an epiphany. Instead of focusing on the DJ, what if we focus on the MC? After all, there was already an infrastructure for music that centered vocalists in the record industry. Most songs centered vocalists. So she searched around for charismatic people who could rap, set up a studio session with live musicians, and had three men that she found later, dubbed the Sugar Hill Gang, lay down a 15-minute song. So instead of the experimentation and improvisation we normally got from the DJs, the studio musicians were told to play the song in a repeating loop, four bars over and over again. And rumor has it, they were threatened not to mess up or to improvise. They had to be strict on repeating this this track. The track, by the way, it's a reproduction of a popular song from the disco scene, Good Times by Chic. So now there was this change that happened in the form of the music. You had these long form verses that were squarely about the MC, and the music was the backup. The instrumental was the backup. And that's the form that hip hop took for decades to come. And this isn't to say that this shift was necessarily bad, but it was something that created a dynamic shift in the sound and the structure of the music that correlated to the type of work that the music was doing. The success of Rapper's Delight established a demand for this approach to music making, for music making, and the MC has been kind of the main feature of hip hop music ever since. By the late 1980s, music expanded from party tracks with, you know, funny punchlines to also include more hard-hitting political commentary. And that's the hip hop that a lot of people refer to when they describe what's missing in contemporary hip hop. By the way, it's not missing. It's not missing in any way, but that's the romanticized narrative we often get. When hip hop shifted from being a grassroots party in the streets that was meant to counter a politics of displacement to being a commoditized music, it also came with changes in its approach, how the audience related to it, and eventually its content. And again, this isn't to say that this was bad. You know, to the contrary, this shift was part of hip hop becoming one of the most central aesthetic movements in the past 50 years. But those changes weren't innocent. You know, they weren't without meaning or cause or drive. And they reflected a lot about the world that the music was made for. So I'll close this kind of brief introduction by bringing us back to today. You know, hip hop is making more shifts musically and aesthetically. You know, it never really stopped. But the changes that we note in music are always dynamically intertwined with the world that produces it. And that goes for all music, by the way, you know, not just hip hop. It's all about a dynamic exchange between the art that's being produced and the work that people are extracting from it, the work that people are doing with it. So as contemporary hip hop evolves in its sound, its content, and its performance methods, what we should ask ourselves, and one of the things that we explore in my course, is not what's lost in those changes, but what does this change signify about the socio-political world it represents? And it takes some critical thinking and some extraction and some contributions from the next generations, you know, the people who grew up with and who understand the contours of music that's coming around to make a contribution to help us expand our perspective about what it is this music is doing and why. All right, with that, I'll yield the floor.
Thank you so much, Dr. Holt. And before we begin our Q&A, maybe Anthony, would you like to say a few words about yourself, your studies, and your experience at Stony Brook?
Well, yes, thank you. So first of all, thank you all for attending tonight. I always love interacting with potential students and students at the university. As introduced, I am a four-year student here at Stony Brook University, and I actually have three majors. So I'm in psychology, sociology, and in health science in the medical docentmacy track. I want to thank Professor Holt for his wonderful presentation on kind of music and its interaction. And I think the word that really came to mind was interdisciplinary. And that's something that you can find at the College of Arts and Sciences at its core. The goal of Stony Brook's Arts College of Arts and Sciences has always been to advance excellence, to cultivate talent, and achieve the aspirations of its students. I wouldn't be here today if not for these pillars that they founded within the foundation of Stony Brook. I really grew up in a small town. I didn't really have much. And for me, Stony Brook was my reach school. It was my dream school. It wasn't something that I kind of had secure. And coming here as a freshman, I think finding my spot, finding my niche where I can have my own sound, I can now hear the symphony of Stony Brook as a senior. And I think I'm just going to keep that motif of music throughout because of our wonderful professor here.
Great. So now we'll begin the Q&A portion of our presentation. So make sure you put your questions in the box, and I'll start with the first one for Professor Holt. How did you first get into studying this area, and what do you most like to bring to the classroom?
Oh, thank you. Two great questions. Actually, my entry point into this area, I didn't see it coming. So I am a classically trained bassist, and I didn't see academia coming. but it really, I fell in love with research and that process. And a bit like what I was talking about toward the end there, one of the things that drew me to talking about hip hop and engaging in that type of work had to do with what I saw was something missing in the research that was there. So I grew up in Atlanta, Atlanta has its own sort of unique history with hip hop, and one that at the time, not very many scholars were talking about. And so there was this frame of hip hop, you know, and how it's understood as great, you know, how we locate good hip hop. And it all had to do with the virtuosity of the poetry. And a lot of the music that I grew up with, you know, was hip hop, but it wasn't really about, you know, the virtuosity of the poetry. It was more about collective chant. And so I saw a lot of texts saying that this is an example of bad hip hop because it's not interesting poetry. And I thought, well, that's not really being in touch with the work that the music is doing and how it's doing it. Interestingly, you know, the music that I kind of grew up with was very similar to the music on the original hip hop scene, you know, before it was commercialized. You know, so it was really just having an interest and knowledge in that music and having a personal connection that made me first say, okay, I need to write a paper. And that led down a much larger path of exploring not just hip hop, but all sort of all popular music, and taking some of the knowledge I had as a musician and putting that in conversation with all of these other different areas in order to give a fuller picture of not just this music, but the world it exists in. And what I like to bring to the courses, opportunities to do things like that. You know, so as we kind of mentioned, I'm pulling from a lot of disciplines for this course. And that is in part because all of those disciplines offer some new lens into the worlds that we navigate. So even in very mundane ways, the worlds that we encounter are always sort of driven by questions of place and race and gender and performance. And, you know, so I think that a fully, you know, grounded exploration, you know, which I'm hoping to offer, takes into account those different disciplines. And one other thing, there are two main things from the course, this course specifically. One is I give students opportunities to write about their own relationships to music and to take the tools that we learn in the course and apply them to the critical work that they're already doing with music, right? Everybody has opinions about music. So we want to put that to theory. And the second thing that I hope students come away with are a set of tools that they can use to interpret the world that they enter, you know, tools that they can use to interpret any sort of music, different approaches that they can offer because, you know, and this is sort of me romanticizing, but learning the music of somebody, learning their music or the music of a people, it goes a long way toward getting to know who those people are, what they value. And so, you know, I like to say that being able to assess music critically and thoughtfully goes a long way toward building connections to people, connections that you might not have imagined that you had.
Wow. Anthony, next question for you. So sorry about that. Three majors. How do you do that? How do you find time? And follow-up question, what do you do outside of studying at Stony Brook?
Yeah, thank you for the great questions. Definitely a lot of planning, a lot of conversations with different counselors, a lot of different moving parts. But Stony Brook has always been very supportive, I think, of creativity. And there's a big banner when you come to campus, if you do come for orientation, that says, like, we are the dreamers, we are the believers. And it just keeps going on with positive words. And I looked at that and I was like, yeah, no, that's true. Because as someone who was going to come in doing one major, that was already a big achievement for me, the first person to go to college. But now to be able to go home with 3 degrees in 4 years, guaranteed in the Mount Sinai health system, working alongside Stony Brook and medical dosimetry, that's a blessing. And it's something I wouldn't have been able to see myself had I not come to Stony Brook. Outside of studying, I really just think hanging out with my friends, trying to figure out where I fit within the world of adults that we are on campus. We're still kind of trying to figure everything out, but we do so creatively. We explore different media and we are encouraged to by our professors and our faculty. I alone have 3 different mentors in 3 different areas. Last year I shared that I was working on research that looked at the different way that sound impacted those that were limited in their mobility. And we were looking at the way that sound influenced body movement differently than regular gait and the way that people would walk normally. And what came out of that was we found that different types of music allowed people to move in different ways that contoured the body and using different nerves, like neural pathways. So that was super interesting, and finding out that, hey, our body has 2 different places of movement just based on song alone. So when you put those 2 pieces together, I'm now taking something that is of interest, like music, but also research, science, healthcare, something that I'm passionate about, and we're putting that together. So while it not be a course and why it may be a lot of studying outside, it's still a passion and it's still something I think I like to explore. So while a lot of my friends like to say that I sleep with one eye open because I'm always working on more projects, I think it really is that we're allowed to play on campus. And I say that with the utmost like respect for all of our professors, because no lab is off bounds. Nothing is restricted to us while we're at the university. I think all you have to do is ask the question and tell someone, hey, I'm interested in this. And they'll be more than happy to go on a 2-hour conversation with you about their research and have them bring along as an assistant on campus.
Thanks. It's great that you brought that up. I just to interject today, I was at the STEAM presentation of arts students working with biomedical engineers. And actually one of the projects was about Parkinson's and using music to develop the neural circuitry. So it's very interesting that you brought that up. I didn't realize you had been part of that in the beginning. That's great. Next question for Professor Holt. It's a long one. When did you decide what you wanted to do? You said it came as a shock to you, as you didn't think you would continue school. So what age did you really know, yeah, I want to do this? And thank you for your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's a really good question. So a bit about me. I attended a conservatory of music. And so the plan from the beginning was, you know, I'm going to go in, I'm going to learn my instrument, I will be an instrumentalist, and that is what I'm going to do. While I was there, I started taking more academic courses because, you know, for reasons, I had extra time in my schedule my course schedule. So I started taking academic courses, and I really, you know, just found an interest in academic courses. So I began taking courses in Africana studies. And after keeping it up for a while, I realized I'm halfway to a second degree. You know, let's just go on and ride this train, you know. So, but even then, my interest or my focus was to be a performing musician and hopefully to be a performing musician who has something smart to say if somebody ever asks me a question. So the path towards academia, it really came later. You know, I was working as a professional musician and I enjoyed it. I still enjoy it. But I really missed research and that sort of led me to go into grad school. Again, just saying, you know, I want to be a more informed person. And that's when I sort of had that epiphany about how the conversation that was happening in popular music discourse wasn't aligned with my experience of certain types of music. So, I went to grad school and then I went to a PhD program. You know, so there wasn't a day, I think. I don't think there was a day where I decided this is exactly the thing that I need to do. But it was something that was driven by following, you know, my interests, following my passions. And by following the things that I was naturally interested in, I sort of carved a path that was, you know, because I didn't take ethnomusicology courses at all in my undergrad, you know, spoiler. But even without, you know, starting my career that way, my interest in culture and anthropology and research along those lines, and my interest in music sort of came together to yield a career that was not just grounded in ethnomusicology, but also very intertwined multidisciplinarily. And, not to, this point has come up already, but it's really a great thing to have a school that allows that type of exploration, because so many novel conversations, so many novel epiphanies come from areas that were imagined as separate, interacting with each other. And this is an institution that really sees value in that.
Thanks. So I think we've intrigued somebody with the triple major, because on Tuesday night we talked about double majors. So the question is, as an international student pursuing a scientific major, would I also be able to have a sociology major or maybe an art major? Or do they have to be related in a way to the scientific major? And how does the process of majoring in an additional subject work? So let me try to answer that one a little bit. It's complicated. It depends on what particular major you're taking. We often see combinations where there's a bit of overlap. So we saw the health sciences and the psychology overlap and then sociology added in. I'm sure some of the core requirements crossover, and that's what helped you be able to do that, Anthony. But there are other options out there. For example, we have a BA in biology. And by being a BA in biology, the requirement is that you have a minor in the College of Arts and Sciences, a non-science minor. So you could be a music minor or an art minor or a sociology minor. There's a health technology and medicine minor in sociology that fits in very nicely with the BA in biology. And the main difference between the biology BA and the BS biology degree is how many upper division laboratories, right? So the bachelor's is really about going into further graduate study in biology, where you do a lot of advanced lab work, and the bachelor's allows you to broaden your horizons and still meet all of the pre-med requirements if you were thinking of going to medical school with that degree. So I would say that's probably our most popular combination, is the BA in biology with the sociology, health technology, health and technology and medicine, or no, sorry, health society and medicine. Sorry, too many things going on in my brain. Health society and medicine minor. So there's many different ways to do it. Some students can do it because they come in with advanced placement credits, and that gets you through some of the early prerequisites and then opens up a little bit more flexibility in your schedule, in flexibility in terms of your course selections of what choices you have. So it really depends on the person, and this is a conversation you should have with academic advising at orientation, and then at many steps along the way. Anthony, you mentioned you had three mentors and three advisors. That's clearly how you pulled this off. I don't know if you want to add anything else to sort of what I just described.
No, yeah, definitely. So I'd like to share that I actually have, I think at this point, over 280 credits.
That's a little scary.
So it's a lot of courses, but what I'd like to say is, even though it's like summers, winters I've spent in school, it's been a lot of studying and it's been a lot of fun along the way. Would I recommend someone else triple major? I don't really know, just because it's a lot. But as someone who never really had, like, has been given the opportunity to go to an institution like Sunnybrook and study, I think I wanted to take full advantage of that. And I actually belong to a program of students that's called EOP, which is Educational Opportunity Students. So we come from high schools that may not have had all the advantages of other schools along Long Island and the boroughs. And we actually make up a large portion of the students of color on campus. And our stats show that our students are graduating in 6 years. Meanwhile, the rest of the campus kind of will finish in 4. So there's a big push for us to kind of make that push and make that leap and close that gap a little. So to be part of the group that's graduating in 4 years, but also being a triple major, double minor, it's like a big celebration within the EOP community that someone's like really shortening that race. But definitely, I think speaking to the advising committee and going, making appointments, is the best way to get all the information, because policy is always changing and a lot of majors will kind of switch what they need. So for me to make sure that I didn't have a lot of overlap, that's why I had a lot of credits. So they limit things and it's always like the best up to date, and just meet with those people to make sure that you're on track for graduation so you can get to do the wonderful things you want to do after college.
And I will say also, you know, depending on what your career goals are, there are, we have a lot of students who come to Stony Brook wanting to be pre-health or pre-medicine. And you do not necessarily have to be a biology major. You can be a music major or an art major and take the other required courses that you need, because those humanities and social science majors have a lot of flexibility in them. You don't all have to be like Anthony taking hundreds of credits. You only need 120 credits to graduate. And you can do that in, say, an art major and still take your psychology, your chemistry, your biology that you need for medical school. Changing it up a little bit. Well, and let me answer one question here asking about the ethnic diversity on campus. Amongst the undergraduates, we're actually majority minority. I think we're about 40 something percent white ethnicity and the rest a mixture of non-white ethnicities. The faculty is, I think, about 65% white ethnicity, so still majority white, but diverse, not as diverse as our undergraduate student body. And that probably reflects that students usually stick around for 4 years, and our country as a whole, the demographics are changing rapidly, whereas faculty are here a little bit longer than 4 years. So the faculty hasn't turned over in ethnicity at the same rate that our general young population has. What are the best places to hang out in Stony Brook's vicinity? Who wants to tackle that one? I'll throw that out at both of you. Unmute.
I guess I can go. Definitely off campus, we have the city, which everyone goes to because we have a train station right on campus. But in the vicinity of Stony Brook alone, I think there's a plethora of food and a lot of different cultures near campus. So we have a really nice sushi spot. We have a movie theater like 5 minutes from campus. There's a really large mall that you can take a bus to that's free on weekends. So there's a lot of things to do within Stony Brook, even though it might seem like it's a little bit secluded on the island. And during the summer months, there's a beach that I think is 5, maybe 7 minutes away from campus. So there's a lot that you can do. It just depends on what you're interested in and what you kind of want to do for that week.
Right. There are actually a lot of beaches around the area because we are on a long island, and they're beautiful. Let me check my questions here. What would you say is, in terms of things to do around Stony Brook, what are the music options for not so much education, well, standard education, but for entertainment purposes? So maybe you could speak a little bit about the types of performances that we have coming through and the opportunities for students to attend things that we have.
There are so many performances and different types of performances. So you have, symphony performances by students and also by faculty. For those of you who aren't aware yet, Stony Brook University has a very strong performance program. And many of the performances that are coming out of the music department and jazz and classical and contemporary performance are really world-class. So I would certainly encourage that. There are places where music just sort of happens spontaneously. You know, so today was a warm day and people were outside of my office window kind of frolicking in the main square. And there was a spontaneous saxophone duet that kicked up. So I think that that there are lots of opportunities to make music and to be audience to music. Now, full disclosure, I am new faculty here, so I'm still learning some of the areas, but there's definitely an abundance of music, and as was mentioned before, we are very close to New York City. And there are lots of performances out there, you know, always, but if you just wanted to stay near campus, there's always going to be some performance somewhere. You know, I see lots of advertisements, and not seeking music, I've definitely encountered music, you know, just walking around campus. I encourage you to take in the organic music making of the campus.
I've been enjoying the saxophone too, because my office is on the opposite side of the Stoller steps from where you are. So yes, there's a regular player out there whenever it's nice. It's a lot of fun. We have a large stadium with sports going on, a great basketball arena, and our basketball teams are very good, and a lot of student attendance at those events. There are a ton of student clubs, and a question just came in about things like dance classes, and I happen to have looked at this. I think there were over 20 or 30 dance clubs of different kinds, probably some hip hop, but other types of dance. Students through the undergraduate student government can get funding for their clubs, and they get together in various spaces to put together performances. And in fact, I've seen many of the dance performances from students at the convocation of new students in the fall. When students first come to campus, they will often perform. So there are many club opportunities. There are esports clubs out there for people to join and participate in. One of the art demonstrations that I saw today was an esports person who turned his coding to lighting up a neural headgear that lights up a light dress sculpture. So it sort of takes what's going on in your brain from an EEG and turns it into lighting. So that, you know, esports can come into all sorts of good use and good art. You have to see that one, I think, to understand. Other things that we haven't covered, Anthony, that you think we should touch on for the students?
I was definitely going to touch upon the clubs. So we have a new student union on campus that I think is something it's important to highlight because it's been 3 years in the making. So I got to campus and I got told we're going to have a new union. And now as a senior, I can finally like take it all in. So the union and the Student Activity Center is really where we all like to hang out when we're not in class. And you can always find an open door to figure out if it's a new hobby, if it's something new you want to take on. There's cooking lessons, always something going on in either of those two buildings. And for the dancing alone, I know people that are in Jubilee, which is a competition team. There's ballroom dancing, there's Bhangra. So of every culture, of every color, every ethnicity, we have it on campus. And we all like to culminate it at the Wolfie Showcase in the fall, which is a really big event, student-led, student-organized, to show off our students. It's like a really big talent show we have on the Stoller steps, and we just come together and celebrate who we are as a university.
Great. And what about vocal music? What are the opportunities to get for students to get involved in vocal music? We've talked about dance, we've talked about instruments, and...
I'm aware of, I think, five vocal groups on campus. Three of them are in collegiate competitions. And really, you can find other pockets of music too. So we have a musical theater group on campus that puts on productions, and they have their own vocal choir. We have an a cappella group of both male and female, just a female and an all male group on campus. And they go around singing Valentine's Day. They did that this past week, where they went around giving Valentine's and they sang songs. But we also just have a little concerts that go on anywhere on campus. If it's a duller week, they'll kind of come out to the square by the fountain and they'll kind of perform for everyone just to lighten the mood.
And we also have a chorus that's led. So the next question is it possible to start on a new instrument that you don't know when you get to Stony Brook? says, I want to have bass as my main instrument, which I'm not that skilled with. Could I continue with bass, or would I have to choose an instrument I'm already experienced in? I don't know if you can answer that, Professor Holt, being new, but.
Yeah, well, you know, the great thing about having a robust music department is that there are different ways to grow your musicianship. So if you're feeling, you know, fairly strong in your foundations. So for instance, if you started playing cello and you want to transition to bass, that's kind of an easier transition over, you know, in terms of skill sets. Then you can probably sign up for lessons with the faculty. But if you're not quite sure that that would be the best move for you, there are many DMA students here. There are music teacher resources outside of just the faculty that you can seek for lessons. I'm not sure from your question whether you want to do electric bass or upright, but I assure you there are people on this campus who are excellent at both. Maybe I could give you some lessons. I'm a bassist.
And just to translate there, DMA is Doctor of Musical Arts. And so there are graduate students who are here studying in various studios of different instruments. And they will, you know, for a fee, teach lessons. In fact, my son took cello for many years from two different DMA students. It's a great experience.
Yeah. So you know, the student artists are a really valuable resource, especially if you're entering as a beginner. So you'll be able to make connections across the campus, in addition to building up your knowledge and your skills of new instruments. So I'd say that if you are very new on an instrument, maybe it's not the move to sign up for the course, you know, with the faculty member, but there are always plenty of opportunities to perform, to practice, and to learn, you know, across campus. And a lot of them have to do with these, the less tangible support or the less curricular driven support that are presence of music educators here.
All right, this is a hard question, Anthony. 280 credits, what's your favorite class?
that is a hard one. I saw it and actually had to think about it for a little bit. I think I can narrow it down to a couple, but if I had to pick one that I really liked, it was honestly my second semester freshman seminar course. And I picked that class because in that class is actually where I had my aha moment at Stony Brook, as I like to call it, because it was the first time I actually felt like I was a part of the community. Before then, I was just kind of floating around. I felt like another number. And you're in these massive lecture halls of like 500 other students in chemistry, and you're crying the night before the exam, or you're trying to figure out how things work. And in that course, I found that everyone else was just like me. I really didn't feel alone. It was a group of like 20 students, and we had gotten this professor that taught geology, and her career was to fly drones and map the different terrain of the earth. And it was something so random, something I would have never thought I was interested in. And lo and behold, 2 years later, here I am flying the drones out with this professor over the ocean. And it's one of the greatest experiences ever. And she's told me amazing things. And I've stuck around with that group of 20 kids, and they became my closest friends. And we would do things together. Some of our assignments were to go to a Staller show or to go to a movie screening on campus, because we like to have movie drive-ins, and we'll go together. And so we'll go to West Side Dining, where they're having a cultural event night. And they force you to kind of leave the safety of your dorm or your house, and you have to go and explore campus. And these assignments started feeling less like work. And we're like, oh, okay, we're just going to go do this today. Or we go have coffee with another professor and just write about what we did with them, or what we shadowed them for that day. So from that freshman seminar course, I think I got a lot of my confidence, and I gained more from that course than I really thought I would, especially for what it was. When you're considering it's just a freshman seminar course, it's just supposed to be another class for you to kind of get your bearings and get on like feet firmly planted on the ground. what it was is that it gave me a running start, I think. And everyone else from that class all says the same thing, that it was the one course that kind of pushed us to go outside of our boundaries and really find who we were on campus.
That's great. Thank you. Now I want to go fly drones. And maybe I can just talk about that chemistry course since I am a faculty member in chemistry as well. For those listening in, we don't want people crying. And so what we have is we have a chemistry learning center where there's a lot of help at all hours of the day and the night in the first floor of the chemistry building. And it gets very crowded the nights before exams, but there's a lot of review sessions, a lot of help sessions, and it's all just part of the Stony Brook experience. It's there for our students because we do want you to succeed. So I'm glad you made it through, Anthony. No. Go ahead.
No, thank you. And I think as students, we go through a big transition from like high school to college. And that's something we haven't really talked about today, but I'm sure you'll hear more about it during your orientations. But Stony Brook has a lot of support set up in all of its classes. It doesn't just need to be a really like hard chemistry course or necessarily a hard math class, because hard is subjective. It's what the students feel like they're struggling with personally. And Stony Brook is always offering either a tutoring session. Professors will often extend their office hours or have Zoom meetings now that this is a tool, and they're constantly changing. And I think we hit it at the beginning of the conversation when we talked about meaningful changes with substance. And when you think about Stony Brook, when you think about the College of Arts and Sciences and our professors, they're doing the same thing. They're following that upbeat and that student trend, and we're setting the pace for what we want to learn. So thank you for the dean. Thank you for letting me be here. But really, with that little comment, I think that's what I wanted to end on from my part, that it's just, Stony Brook is just amazing.
Well, thank you for that. And Dr. Holt, last words, last thoughts. Anything we haven't touched on?
Well, you know, I think I've probably, you know, tapped on this before, you know, just in talking, but I want to, you know, double down, because everything that we've talked about today goes back to being flexible about what you want, being flexible about what you want, and sort of forging a path. So, you know, there are traditions, there are structures that, you know, we all navigate. But when you're here, or when you're in college, you have the opportunity to really explore and to pull from your resources the things that inspire you. And as I, you know, I mentioned before, you know, that process of pulling from these different things often lead you down paths that you're not even sure that you didn't know existed. And I encourage you all to really take those interests that you already have, those things that you're bringing with you, and to see where they take you. You know, if you hear about an event or you hear about an audition, you hear about a course that just stands out to you for whatever reason, even though it wasn't a part of your original plan, check it out. And you never know where it could lead. You know, it's really a fertile time to explore and to grow. And I think what you'll find is even if those courses that you take or those experiences that you take on aren't, don't manifest as a part of the ultimate plan in the way that you anticipated, they'll make a contribution to your path. And it's one that you'll likely take with you wherever you go.
Great advice. And with that, I see that we've answered all of the questions. So I just like to take a moment to thank our admissions team, Ryan, Johnny, and Lyle, who've helped us bring today's presentation to you and helped us this evening. So with that, unless there are any further questions, let's thank Anthony and Professor Holt here for sharing their experiences and their expertise, and looking forward to seeing you at Stony Brook in the fall as a Sea Wolf.